Are you here for the synth?
I'm here to pick up an order. 2 large pepperoni and a calzone. Name is Fuck You.
What's up, guys? Welcome back to Philly Cheese Gaming. My name is Philip, but you can call me Philly Cheese. Today I've got another entry in my character guide series, a hard-drinking synth hunter known as the Blade Runner. As with all of my character guides, we're going to define the character and the target playstyle, and then discuss the perks and equipment you'll need to achieve that playstyle. I'm going to make some very strong recommendations when it comes to your path through the main story, and you're of course free to do whatever you like when playing your game. With that being said, I think I found an interesting way to loosely emulate the story of our source material, and I think it makes for a very unique playthrough. Blade Runner has always been my favorite movie, and it seems like someone at Bethesda has a soft spot in their heart for it as well, because the whole Synth Revolt storyline feels very Blade Runner to me. It's all based on a novel called Do Androids Dream of Electric Sheep by Philip K. Dick, in case you didn't know. Our Blade Runner character is going to be equal parts based on the movie character, the novel character, and the Fallout universe as a whole. Now sit back, relax, and prepare to open up a new case file on the Blade Runner. Rick Deckard was born to a hard-working, middle-class family in Boston. His mother was a teacher and his father was a police officer. When Deckard was only 9, his father was shot to death on duty while trying to apprehend a known carjacker. Deckard had idolized his father and decided very quickly that he would grow up and follow in his footsteps and become a police officer himself. Deckard's mother, on the other hand, turned to alcohol to cope with the loss. She was never abusive towards her son, but the constant drinking did put a strain on their relationship. During high school, Deckard ran track and cross country, eventually competing at the state level with his natural athleticism. He never told his friends, but in his mind, he was preparing himself to be the best cop he could by conditioning his body for both sprinting and distance running. This internal drive to succeed led to the Blade Runner becoming something of a track star at his local high school, which in turn brought him a lot of female attention. No longer close with his mother, Deckard fell into something of a party lifestyle, hanging out with lots of different girls and going to parties. It wasn't long before he himself started drinking as well, although he didn't let it interfere with his school or his athletic training. He still had a goal in mind. After graduating high school, Deckard immediately enrolled in the Boston Police Academy, where he excelled in evidence analysis, criminal apprehension, and firearms training, particularly with pistols. 2 years later, the Blade Runner graduated from the academy and accepted a job as a patrol officer in Lexington. However, the war with China escalated, and Deckard was drafted into the army, where he served as an intelligence analyst. His superiors quickly noticed that he had a knack for tracking high-value targets, even through the chaos of multiple battle zones. When his tour of duty was up and he returned to his home in Lexington, his distinguished service during the war meant that he was immediately promoted within the police force to the rank of detective. The Blade Runner found he enjoyed his work tracking and arresting dangerous criminals, and during the course of an investigation, he met a young defense attorney named Nora. Deckard's life experiences had left him cynical and somewhat cold, but Nora was the complete opposite, with a real thirst for life and an optimism about people that Deckard found strangely alluring. After a few dates and more than a few drinks, things got intimate, and the two would eventually fall in love and have a son. It seemed like the Blade Runner had finally achieved a life that his father would have been proud of. However, once again the war would escalate, and when the bombs fell, Deckard's carefully crafted life would be torn to pieces. Vault-Tec screening will reveal that the Blade Runner has 1 strength, 2 perception, 2 endurance, 6 charisma, 4 intelligence, 6 agility, and 7 luck. We will be using the Your Special Book in Sanctuary on Charisma to bring that up to 7, and don't forget to grab the Perception Bobblehead in the room where you first meet Preston Garvey. I actually forgot to do this when I was making this build, and didn't realize it until much later on, so it's definitely not necessary. However, we are going to be using a ton of VATs in this playstyle, so the added accuracy bonus from another point in Perception would be a great thing to have. Deckard will leave Vault 111 angry about the death of his wife and desperate to find his son. He will form uneasy ties with any group that seems like it might be able to help him, but will always keep their goals secondary to his own. He will also quickly turn back to his old friend alcohol to keep him numb to the horrors of this strange new world. Upon accessing the Institute and finding his son, Deckard will initially decide to join up. Working with X688 to recover the rogue synth from Libertalia feels very familiar to the Blade Runner and reminds him of his work before the war, so he settles in working reclamation missions for the Synth Retention Bureau. He still keeps up shaky ties with the Brotherhood and the Minutemen, but quickly makes enemies of the railroad while working for the SRB. During his travels, Deckard will occupy his evening hours with booze and women, and will always ask for more money for a job so that he can keep these habits satisfied. Eventually, the Blade Runner's travels will bring him to Vault 81, where he will stumble across Curie. Deciding that a medical robot is a good thing to keep around, the two begin to travel together. Curie's bright demeanor and naivety about the post-nuclear world reminds Deckard of his former wife, although he stays too drunk to really notice it. He just knows that he likes having that funny little French robot around. One night, when the Blade Runner is particularly drunk, Curie starts rambling on to him about inspiration and wanting to be more human. She asks to be taken to Good Neighbor, and Deckard agrees, not entirely understanding what is going on. Before he has the chance to even properly sober up, Curie is standing before him in a brand new synth body, and not an unattractive one either. Actually, she looks awfully familiar to the Blade Runner. You can probably see where this is going next. Curie is in a new, essentially human body, flesh with new sensations and emotions. Deckard has a fondness for women and a weakness for alcohol. Add these things together and you get one hell of an awkward morning after. Despite the initial strangeness of it all, Deckard finds himself returning to Curie time and time again for companionship, and she doesn't seem to complain about further experimenting with her new body. Before long, the Blade Runner starts to develop real feelings for Curie. He realizes that he can no longer remain a part of the Institute, as they would surely try to reclaim his lover if they ever found out the truth. Even the man that was once his son would never be able to understand. Having already made enemies of the one group that would stand and fight against the Institute, Deckard will see no option but to do what he always does, run. Deckard and Curie will run away to Diamond City, where they will work to make a new life for themselves. Deckard will partner up with Nick Valentine and work detective cases, doing his best to stay beneath the notice of both the Institute and the Railroad. He might even get facial reconstructive surgery. Eventually, if he decides that the Institute can no longer be ignored, the Minutemen will be there to help the Blade Runner finish the fight. The Brotherhood would destroy Curie if given the chance, and therefore, they are also enemies to either be ignored or destroyed. Our version of the Blade Runner has no real interest in settlement building, but you are of course free to do what you like. With that having been said, you might want to alter your perk selection, as the path I recommend does not include any crafting or settlement perks at all. I do recommend purchasing Home Plate in Diamond City and decorating it to your liking. Make sure and leave plenty of booze laying around, and Deckard will need a little office area to work on cases. Now let's talk about the Blade Runner's equipment. As a former police officer, Deckard received extensive training in the use of pistols, and this training will serve him well in the wasteland. We will be using a 10mm pistol as our primary weapon, and this represents Deckard's service weapon from the police force. You'll want to upgrade it as best you can, and replace it as you find better versions. You'll also want to carry a pipe revolver and a 44 Magnum, because 10mm ammo can sometimes be scarce. It's also nice to have a little bit of variety in your weaponry. The Blade Runner will wear whatever clothing and armor he finds until he gets his hand on a faded trench coat. You will be given one by Nick Valentine fairly early on in the main story, so don't worry about trying to track one down. You should also supplement the trench coat with either the Trilby hat or a fedora, and whichever pair of glasses you prefer. This will increase your perception and your charisma, both of which are important for this build. We will not be using any armor, so if you want to follow the railroad quests long enough to unlock ballistic weave, you certainly can. I didn't find it necessary, and I like the challenge posed by the Blade Runner's somewhat fragile nature. I tend to enjoy playing glass cannons. Following those same lines, our Blade Runner does not use power armor unless absolutely necessary. Finally, we will be giving ourselves some nice combat boosts with alcohol. There are several alcoholic drinks in the game, but we will want to stock up on bourbon, vodka, wine, and beer. Bourbon and vodka both will boost our endurance and therefore our health. Wine gives us a bonus to our max AP, and beer will be used before conversations to increase our charisma and help us pass speech checks. Finally, alcohol bottles will be set aflame and hurled at our enemies in times of desperation. Now that we've gone over Deckard's backstory and equipment, it's time to actually build our Blade Runner. As always, we will be going level by level up to 15, and then I will provide some recommendations for continuing into the higher levels. At our first level up, we're going to take Gunslinger to increase our damage with pistols by 20%, and this represents Deckard's previous training with handguns. Next up at level 3, we're going to take Action Boy to increase our AP regeneration rate. We're going to be using VATS whenever possible, so this perk is a must. At level 4, we will be taking Toughness to help counter our lack of armor. At level 5, we will take Party Boy. This makes it so that we cannot become addicted to alcohol, which is nice, but it's really the second rank where this perk shines. We'll get to that in a bit. At level 6, we're going to take the first rank of Hacker, which will allow us to access advanced terminals. This represents skills gained during the Blade Runner's time in the military as an intelligence analyst. Also, in the movie, Deckard makes use of a few computerized devices in his hunt for the missing replicants, and I wanted to be sure to include this in the build. At level 7, we will be taking Ladies' Man, giving us a damage bonus against women in combat and a bonus when trying to persuade women in dialogue. Be sure to use this to flirt whenever possible. It also helps when asking for more money when turning in quests to a woman. Be sure to drink a beer before trying to flirt in Fallout as well as in real life. Levels 8 and 9 will see us taking the 1-2 combo of Critical Banker and Battle Criticals so we can put down tougher enemies with ease. Next up at level 10, we will be taking Moving Target, and this further increases our survivability. Be sure to sprint to close the distance with enemies before finishing them off in vats, and they will deal a lot less damage to you. At level 11, we will be taking Scrounger to help keep our pistols fed. Unwanted ammo types can also be sold for caps. At level 12, we will take Medic to increase the effectiveness of Stim Packs and Rataway. And at level 13, we will be taking the second rank of Gunslinger to further increase our damage with pistols. At level 14, we will take the second rank of Toughness for some added protection as our enemies get stronger. And finally, at level 15, we will be taking the second rank of Party Boy. Party Boy rank 2 doubles the effects of alcohol, meaning that wine now gives you twice as much extra AP, bourbon and vodka give you twice as much added health, and beer makes you twice as smooth with the ladies. Beyond level 15, I recommend continuing to rank up the perks we already have. You can definitely top off your agility and take Gun Fu if you wish, or perhaps finish out the luck tree and take the four-leaf clover. Personally, I plan to invest in Perception up to rank 7 and take Night Person. This is purely for role-playing purposes, as there is not one single daytime scene in the movie Blade Runner, unless you count that stupid driving away scene at the end, but the director cut that out in his final cut. Anyway, the nighttime stat boosts are great too. And that's all she wrote, folks. I hope you've enjoyed watching the Blade Runner character guide as much as I enjoyed making it. He's got a cool classic detective aesthetic and a really noir vibe, and I ended up taking him on a pretty unique path through the main story. Be sure and let me know what you think in the comments section below. If you were building the ultimate synth hunter turned sympathizer, what would you have done differently? Be sure to drop a like if you enjoy drunk Fallout, and hit that subscribe button so you don't miss out. I've got plenty more Hollywood-inspired character builds on the way. Also, if you feel like carrying a little bit of Fallout around with you in real life, why not check out my wife and I's online shop, Runaway Robot Crafts, on Etsy. Right now, we're offering a line of Nuka-Cola-inspired items, and we're working on adding new products all the time, so take a look and tell your friends. But enough shameless self-promotion. Thanks for watching, and I'll see you guys next time. This is Philly Cheese, signing off.